So 8 minutes past 10 o'clock on a Friday morning, the 17th of July. Now, I've got to say that until all the excitement and the coverage surrounding last year's Tour de France, with racing starting in Yorkshire, of course, I've never really thought that much about the effort and the sheer determination involved in either competitive or indeed long-distance cycling. I don't think I'm the only person involved who is in awe of the riders. Team Sky's Chris Froome, of course, leading the way in the yellow jersey in this year's race at the moment. Last year's tour covered around 2,200 miles, which I thought was pretty darn impressive. That was until I met Tony Ives, who spent last summer cycling a mere 4,000 miles across America, east to west, Yorktown, Virginia, to San Francisco. Tony, who lives on the outskirts of York, is about to set off on another epic adventure because, well, he's a glutton for punishment, or he just takes great joy in the cycling. Good morning and welcome back.
Good morning, Jonathan.
Can I invite you just pull forward a bit against the microphone?
That's fine.
Nice to have you back with us in
Thank
the
you.
Studio. Why are you going to do it again?
The joy of being on a bicycle with the tarmac beneath my wheels and seeing different places and different people. And I don't know, where else can you get a suntan? Eat as much as you like and get remarkably fit.
No, it is quite a good combination. So just tell us about the journey then. Well, what's your start point and what's your end point?
I'm flying into Toronto next week, and I really wanted to get to a place that was really just north of the United States border. Toronto is a good place I can get to on an aeroplane. I'm then cycling down really directly south, going via Niagara Falls, which isn't a bad stop on the first day, is it?
Have you seen Niagara Falls before?
I have, a long time ago.
Horribly touristy place.
It is, well, I'll be passing through. But it's a good start, and then cycle down Lake Erie, and then really start just going directly south. I'm going actually on a route called the Underground Railroad, which is mapped, and it's a strange name, but it's to do with the escape of African Americans during the years of slavery, where they were trying to get to Canada in order to get free. So that's an interesting route. There'll be some sights on that. But when I get to Louisville, the home of Muhammad Ali, I shall then go directly south to Nashville, which I suppose is my first prize, because I'm quite excited to get to the home of country music.
So you're a big country music fan?
Oh, desperate. Yes, my children have even got the bug as well. So I'm spreading it.
Obviously a genetic thing. Let's just go back to that journey that you did before, because you came on the show and you chatted to us most eloquently about that experience. And I'm just thinking back to what you told me about that. And the thing that really sticks out in my mind about that previous journey, east to west, was the encounters that you had on the way. And I think I remember you saying something to me along the lines of what you hadn't really expected was just to take such joy or curiosity in meeting so many different people.
Yeah, I think one of the big things about a trip like this is that you have preconceived ideas about people and nations and what they sort of like and don't do and all the rest of it. And to get amongst it, we're all nice people, aren't we, really? Everyday folk. I think going through the United States, I met some gracious, generous and very courteous people who made me very welcome. And so I've really got some enthusiasm thinking that it's going to be another good ride. I mean, I'll have my time with puppies again, but I'm going to
just explain.
Yes, well, no doubt. In certain parts of the United States, there are a lot of dogs that are not on a leash. And I don't know why, but if a bicycle goes past, it's just complete sport for them. And
I say it's an Englishman on board. Let's
taste different. Hey,
let's have some fun with him.
So that's something which is to be thought about. But no, the people are lovely, and I think that I'm going to a different. I went through the Midwest, which was farming, obviously sparsely populated, but some lovely people. But going to the Deep South, a lot of different culture down there, different climate, and different people. So again, that's really exciting for me.
Yeah, and some spectacular scenery on the way. I mean, I'm just thinking, I mean, I have been to that little bit of the United States and right to Canada. Right. And just, you come down, I'm not quite sure what route you're taking, but is it the Adirondacks, and it's the Delaware Water Gap and things like that as you start to head south from...
It might be. I mean, I don't know by those names, but I go along Lake Erie after I get past Niagara. Then I come directly, really, I suppose it's still a bit of an angle, but come down south. But the only thing I can tell you, Jonathan, which is really good news, is it's not as hilly as the last time.
Why have you chosen this route? Well, because...
Oh, believe me.
Well, north to south, obviously it's downhill, isn't it?
Well, of course, yes. with a tailwind.
What did you learn from the experience last time that is informing, first of all, your choice of route this time, apart from the fact that you're ironing out some of the up?
Well, actually, that's a serious point. I tell you what, this is quite interesting. I mentioned before that you don't, you have preconceived ideas about the Americans, but also you start to understand the history. I mean, for instance, I saw Mustang horses last time. So you look at Mustang horses, they were introduced by the Spanish. Well, how did the Spanish, who never got that far north in the United States, how did they get up there? The Native Americans. You go back to the history of cowboys and Indians, how were the Indians were so effective upon horseback? Because they took these very mobile small horses. And so you start to learn so much stuff. And I have to say, talking about African Americans and the history of it, I know about their culture, wonderful music, but the thing is that, tell me something else about their progression and why they are where they are and do bits and pieces and their views upon things. So it's a bit of a discovery, and I just know it'll open up so many things I've had preconceived ideas about or had scant knowledge on. I'll learn more.
Okay. We don't do this for all our guests, but we did ask you about a piece of music, yes. And you've chosen this. Do you want to explain what it is and why you want it?
Yes. On my trip, I'm going to go to a place called Muscle Shoals, which is a strange name, but it's basically 20 miles south of the Tennessee border in Alabama, and it happens to have two remarkable radio recording studios, of which one had famously a house band. And a lot of artists recorded there, Rolling Stones, Paul Simon, Aretha Franklin. But this was a major hit in 1972 by the Staple Singers, and I'll take you there, which seems appropriate.
Let's hear it. Singers, and I'll take you there on BBC Radio York.
Sunday Gardening. This week we're live at
on a Friday morning, talking this morning to Tony Ives, the man who previously has cycled across the United States, east to west. He's going to do it again in just a few days' time, but he's going from north to south. Do you have to keep repeating it to yourself, I really am going to do this, just in order to get the idea lodged in your mind? Is there something psychological about doing this?
Well, there is, but the other thing is that I can't believe I did it last time.
You did. You came in, you talked about it, unless you were making it all up, which I don't think you were, and you blogged about it last time.
I did it, but it does still seem very daunting, Jonathan.
How long ago was it?
It was about a year ago.
Only about a year ago,
yeah.
And you've recovered. What sort of training have you been doing for this? Because presumably in the interim, you know, you're, in spite of however much you cycle, your fitness will decline a little bit.
Yes, in some ways you get fitter as you proceed, and also the bicycle's a lot heavier, so you train upon a road bike here. Now I've done about 2,400 miles, so I kind of warmed up for the trip.
What about the practicalities of going on your way? I mean, do you have accommodation booked every night, or how do you do it?
No, I have an idea where I'm going to stay and where I'm going to get to every day, and I base that upon the average mileage that I did last time, so I can work out where I'm going to go and what might be there. Last night I was checking out a campsite just a bit south of Niagara Falls and communicating with the camp owner, saying that, oh, if I don't get there, is it a problem? And said, well, do I need to book it? And said, no, but we do shut at 9. so I think it would be dark by then, so I'll definitely have got there. So yes, I do that kind of research, and when I go to the major cities, I'll be staying either in a hotel or a hostel, so I kind of have to work that out.
How does having a bike in a big American city, how does that work out? Because I'm not sure that America is as cycle-friendly as the UK is.
Yes, well, last time, apart from when I got to San Francisco, the biggest town I cycled into was about 150,000 in population, and I wouldn't say it was very cycle-friendly. Going to Nashville, Memphis, New Orleans, I'll have to think quite a lot about how I get in there. But there are cycle routes in there. People do cycle. But yes, I think it will be difficult, and I should be checking that out in some detail to ensure that I can try and avoid most of the traffic.
Yeah, we've got this crazy English guy who thinks he can ride his bike down one of our highways.
Yes, well, that has happened before.
And what about, I mean, these iconic places you're going to? I mean, we just played some of your music there, which is associated with, I want to say the name again, Muscle Shoals.
Muscle Shoals.
So it is like a muscle in your body.
Yes.
And a shoal of fish out at sea.
Yes.
And this is important to you, as well as a number of other places en route, musically, because they are associated with some of the iconic figures that you're so keen on.
Yes, I mean, from African-American music came rock and roll, came the blues, came some parts of the country, because, in fairness, country was sort of poor white man music, and obviously they were working in the same farms and the same places, a lot of the African-Americans. So in some ways, from that part of the United States, it's informed and made my life, really, with my giant record collection. And the thing is that going back to it, is an opportunity to sort of visit some of the institutions, some of the museums, some of the birthplaces, and also hopefully hear some live music. So I do believe it all starts and finishes there. And you take the Rolling Stones. I mean, clearly, some of their catalogue, again, going back to the 60s, was very much American blues music brought up to date. And in fact, the Rolling Stones recorded Brown Sugar at Muscle Shoals and Wild Horses. So I think if people actually knew from their record collections and their favourite music how much was recorded in some of these places, they'd be surprised.
Have you been there before?
I have been to Memphis. I passed through in 1978, so my memory's getting a bit fuzzy.
That's a while ago, that is, yes.
And I did go to Graceland. And I've been to New Orleans, although I didn't do much of a tour there, and I'm quite enthusiastic too about the jazz.
Do the folks there know you're coming?
No, gosh, no, I don't think so. I think a lot of people pass through. I think it might be a bit of a novelty when they find out someone's got there by a bicycle.
Yeah, you must tell them. I mean,
well,
you know,
give me an idea.
Your local American radio station will turn up with their radio car to meet this wonderful, crazy English guy who's going north to south looking for the great musical venues. It sounds like quite an expedition. Your final sort of stop off on your trip is where?
I get to Orlando,
right?
But just joking with Adam before coming through, that I get to New Orleans, which is really, I suppose, the end of the musical tour.
Yeah.
But then there's just a slight matter of 700 miles to actually meet the family, and through West Florida. And
so you're having a family holiday at the end of this.
Well, you need to relax after this holiday, don't you, Johnson?
Yes.
I mean, for heaven's sake, I mean, you need to pull my. Get my energy back.
You did say a minute or two ago, my giant record collection. I'm sure somewhere is thinking, how giant? What qualifies as giant?
Oh, well, I suppose my iPod's got 18,000 songs. I've got 2,500 albums and all sorts of genres. So, yeah, I mean, it's a passion. I kind of listen to music every day, and as my wife will tell you, I catalogue it alphabetically and research it and... one of the things I've been doing on this trip is, of course, trying to get to some birthplaces. And so I've been going through lots of artists and seeing where they were born to see if I actually sort of cycle near where they are. So, again, it takes up quite a lot of hours of the day.
Look me in the eye and tell me you haven't actually worked out how you can program the iPod so that you're playing the relevant music as you arrive at the relevant location.
Well, this is true. I have to say what I have done, though. I've downloaded onto my iPod a lot of podcasts. I'm really into podcasts. And if you just go onto iTunes, there's so many about American music and country music and blues. So, you know, quite a lot of the artists. So say I'm going to sort of get to the Mississippi Delta. I mean, I've got podcasts on John Lee Hooker and B.B. King. So, you know, and when I get the jazz again, people and artists who I'm probably not so knowledgeable upon, again, I'll be swatting as I'm riding.
You're going to be the best informed visitor to most of these birthplaces and museums.
Well, I'm working on it.
You'll be able to tell them a thing or two when you get there. Listen, it's been great to see you again this
morning.
Tony. If you want to follow Tony's journey, can I point people towards the blog spot?
I'll be delighted.
It is www.toronto-neworleans, all one word, -orlando.blogspot.co.uk. So that's toronto-neworleans-orlando.blogspot.co.uk. Is there something there already?
If people go there, there's two or three entries.
Have a very, very good time. I remember last time you had one or two encounters with, well, you've mentioned the dogs. There was a bear as well, wasn't there, en route last time?
Yes, I was having a conversation with my wife last night, and I said, I bet he mentions the bear. And I said, well, obviously, if I go to the zoo in Nashville, I'll definitely see one. I don't know what I'll see, but I'm going through the same country. So the thing is that there's every chance, and I'll try and get my camera out this time.
All right, you're back mid-September, something like that.
That's right.
Can we make a date that you'll join us again in the studio and tell us about this experience?
That'd be lovely.
All right, I'll follow the blog. Tony, thank you very much indeed. Have a great journey. A musical extravaganza, north to south, across the United States of America, or up and down in the United States of America. Tony Ives, again, that blog spot, worth just keeping a note of it now and starting to follow it, toronto-neworleans-orlando.blogspot.co.uk. And Tony will join us again sometime when he's back from his American adventure.